Good morning. Welcome here during this holiday week, I guess. Hope everyone has enjoyed family and good times. Before we get started, I would like to pass around, we have several clipboards here. One is for Sunday school helpers. They're in great need for the preschool and kindergarten kids and for the upper elementary kids. Each week is laid out here. You need a couple of volunteers. The second one is for the breads. This is for the popcorn festival, Joe? Farmer's market? Okay, for the farmer's market each week, then, if you're able, you can sign up and contribute to that cause. I'll get these started. Let's all take a moment, if you're able, to stand and greet those that are near you. Just a reminder to everyone, the red folders at the end of each pew there, appreciate if you would register your attendance here. Now let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship, worshiping God as we silently listen to the prelude. Thank you. Thanks, Jim and Gary. I was going to comment. Obviously, it was all appreciated here. It's beautiful. If you're able, let's please stand and say the call of worship responsively. The Lord has rewarded me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hands in his sight.
To the faithful, you show yourself faithful. To the blameless, you show yourself blameless.
To the pure, you show yourself pure. But the crooked, you show yourself screwed. Now let us say our opening prayer together. Lord, we humbly bow down before you, giving you praise and glory. Help me to know who I am in Christ, as my prayers can be honest and meaningful communication with you.
Remind me to keep my focus on you at
all times. Amen.
Morning. I don't want to cast any aspersions or accuse anyone, but I heard a rumor this morning, and I'm not sure how true it is, but there's someone in this room right now that just had a birthday. Now, I don't know, I'm not sure who it is, but I think I do. Why don't we sing happy birthday to him? Would you like to play to your own birthday? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Gary. Happy birthday to you. Now, are you Jack Benny's age? Jack Benny's age? Remember Jack Benny?
Yeah.
35? 35? Yeah. Okay. How many of you remember Popeye, the sailor man? Wasn't it he that used to say, I am what I am? Did he used to say that? Well, listen to this.
I am what I am because of His grace. For one spotless lamb, He died in my place. All my sins are forgiven. My past is erased. I am what I am because of His grace. I can stand here and tell you what I used to be. I can tell of the change that's come over me. But the Lord sent His grace when He died on the tree. So I'll let the blood Jesus shed speak for me. I am what I am because of His grace. For one spotless lamb, He died in my place. All my sins are forgiven. My past is erased. I am what I am because of His grace. I was lost and undone. Now I'm found and fulfilled. God traded His Son for my shame and my guilt. Now I am His child, no longer sin slave. His mercy has made me what I am today. I am what I am because of His grace. For one spotless lamb, He died in my place. Sins are forgiven, my past is erased. I am what I am because of His grace. I am what I am because of His grace. For one spotless lamb, He died in my place. All my sins are forgiven. My past is erased. I am what I am. I'm saved by grace. What I am, my past is erased. I am what I am because of His grace. I'm saved by grace.
Dave, for blessing us with that song, very much so. Will you ushers come forward to receive our morning offering? Let us pray. God, all that we have is Yours. All that we own is Yours. Now, during this service time, we have a chance to give back to you. Bless these gifts and bless the givers. And may they be used to further your kingdom here on this universe. Amen. Well, we got six of you up here. That's great. So good to have you. You know, this is a special time in every service that we have just for you boys and girls, and it's good to have you here. Let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Well, I got an answer already. What is prayer? God? Prayer is God? Well, that's not too bad of an answer. Try. What is prayer?
Praying. Won't that be our sins?
Something for our sins. I didn't catch what. Praying for our sins, you mean? Oh, praying for our sins. Okay, that's what we can do with prayer, but still, what is prayer? That's what we can do with our prayer, is pray for our sins. What can we do? What is prayer?
A prayer.
A prayer. You're doing, you're a prayer. All right, good. Anybody? Well, when you're trying to make it hard. So, here. Prayer. Isn't it just talking with God?
Nope. Yep.
Yeah. Yep. Nope. Yep. Yeah. All right. Yeah, it's part of talking with God. That's what prayer is. When we just talk with God. Now, we can talk with God in numerous different ways. We can talk with God when you're going to bed at night. When you sit down and eat, you can talk with God. You can talk with God doing anything. And you can talk with God wherever you might be. You can talk, be in communication with God. Well, that's a good time with prayer of God, yeah. Didn't catch all that, but. You went to Cedar Point?
One day.
Yeah. Did you talk with God there?
Yeah.
When did you talk with God?
I saw him on the Magnum 200.
Okay. You talk with God when on the Cedar Point and the Magnum 200, so you weren't scared. That's good. See? That's very good. That you could talk with God that way. And we're glad that you can talk with God. Even at Cedar Point, you can talk with God. Now, some people say you have to, only way you can talk with God is you've got to put your hands like this. Well, not necessarily. I doubt if you had your hands like this when you were on the Magnum, were you? No, you weren't. Oh, I don't think so. So you can talk with God any way that you want to and doing anything. It's just like having words with God. Can you remember that? Can you remember that? Just having words with God, and you can just say, God, you're here. Let me talk with you. Okay, how about a word of prayer right now? God, we're thankful for these boys and girls. Let them realize truly they can talk with you at all times. Amen. Okay. Good to have you here.
For our prayer time, we have several who have come in here
And I hope that you'll keep these people in your prayers. Shirley Utley family. Shirley passed away, and they truly need your prayers anytime you're going through difficult like that. Marilyn Heathley, because she is battling cancer, so keep her in your prayers. Nettie Criswell is having a rough time at the particular time with some medical problems, and I hope that you could keep her in your prayers as she is going through that. And then in the hospital, we have two people who I hope you also keep in your prayers. Janet Lucas is there, and Kay Castle. So I would hope you could keep all these people in your prayers at this time. Let us go to God in prayer. God, in our quietness, we have been lifting these five people up to you, whose names have been lifted up. And each of them has their own separate needs, but we know that you can meet those needs, and we're thankful for that. Thankful that you have the power and the strength to meet their needs. And we go, and we know you will be there with them. We go through each day knowing that you can walk with us step by step, supporting us, guiding us, and loving us, and we're thankful for that. And we know, God, that you are here with each one of us here this morning, and any unspoken requests, you are meeting them also. God, there's so many things that we can lift up to you, and so many things we should lift up to you. And we are praying, dear Heavenly Father, that you will take all the needs. We've just gone through a wonderful 4th of July weekend. Not weekend, but during the middle of the week. And we know that truly, as we watch the fireworks go off, we can be reminded of the wonderful freedom that we have in this country. A wonderful freedom. Freedom, truly, that we can now say and do and speak and believe. And we know it's wonderful that we can have those freedoms. And they are there. Why? Because many people have fought and died for us. And so we remember those. We remember those people who truly were in our service, and many have watched over us by fighting for our freedoms. Bless them. Bless all people everywhere. And bless our country. We know truly you are here with us. And our prayer is that the leaders will begin to follow your will. Support us. Support them. And guide us this day in all things and in all ways. And we offer this prayer to you through your Son who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
Today's scripture comes from Luke chapter 18, 9 through 14. If you're able, please stand. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. God, I thank you that I am not like other men, robbers and evildoers and adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. This is the word of God from long ago for the people of God today.
I hope you've been keeping Pastor Therese in your prayers. She's traveling across Canada, and I know she's across there now and out camping, so I hope you'll continue to keep her in your prayers. I teased her before she went that she fell on rocks when she was fishing and broke some ribs. I hope that she didn't break anything else while she was out on her vacation. So I hope you'll keep her in her prayers, and I'm sure she'll be back very quickly. Let us be in an attitude of prayer. God, be with us as we go through this day. Help us to hear you and speak you and respond to what you want to say to us. Bless us in all things. Amen. I'm going to begin my sermon this morning by asking you a question. How many of you have ever traveled faster than the allotted speed limit? Well, boy, from the response, I think I know what the answer is. I mean, if I really wanted to go so far and ask you definitely how many to confess and hold up your hands, I bet you we'd have everybody here in the congregation from the response putting up your hands, right? Now, I assure you, this is not one of those holier-than-thou statements from a pastor, for I've gotten a couple speeding tickets too. But I lived in a town once that was known as a speed trap. And why was it a speed trap? Well, they had a habit of placing a police car at one end of the town on a nice street, a four-lane highway that just begged you to go faster than the speed limit. And in that police car that was at one end of the town, what would they do? They put a mannequin in it, in a police uniform. Well, that was fine, except at the other end of town, there was the true police car sitting there with the officer with a radar gun, and whenever they did that, they must have had two or three cars always pulled over. That town didn't have any city income tax. They didn't need it. They got enough money out of the speeding tickets to pay all their bills. Now, I said this is the first service, also. And nobody asked me what town it was, but I'm not going to tell you unless you want to know. So, but you know, every time we get into the car, and I know whenever I'm driving, and you might be on Interstate 70 or 71 or wherever it is, and suddenly the traffic sudden in front of you slows down, what are you going to do? You're going to slow down too, because you know there's a policeman right up there with a speed trap. You know that, and he's just waiting for you. In one state, they were experiencing or trying out an idea of zapping your car with radar and then having another police person down the road pull you over. Another state was trying to slow down the cars by having a plane fly over the roads, especially the interstates, and zapping your car with radar. And then when you got home, a day or two later, you'd get in the mail your speeding ticket with a picture of where you were and the time that you did it and all this kind of stuff. And these are the fines that you have to pay. They thought that was pretty good because they had no messy problems with troopers pulling over belligerent and sometimes dangerously angry drivers. Well, those are just a few of the many different types of speed traps that you can find. And there's quite a few more, but I'm not going to spend the whole time talking about speed traps as far as your cars. But there are other traps, too, that we can find ourselves getting caught up in as we live our lives. If we are not careful, we can find ourselves getting caught up into the traffic of a trap when we're sitting there and we reach over and get that last donut in our back, and our back of our mind is nobody's going to know it. And as you eat it. Or there may be you go out and do some other things. And in your back of your mind, you're saying, oh, nobody's going to know it. And yet, that does happen. There are all kinds of traps that we can find ourselves getting caught in. And we have to be careful. And some of these traps can even come into our Christian life and even ruin them. One area where the traps might creep in is our prayer life. And the traps are there, and they can impede our prayers and even destroy them and definitely render them completely powerless if we aren't careful. These traps can delude us into thinking that we are praying when what we may be doing in reality is merely mouthing a bunch of words. They have no power because there is no connection between you and God. If your prayer life has ever had a little time and you feel like I'm not really getting anywhere, maybe it's because your prayers are simply tied up in one of these traps. An awareness of them can help us to avoid the pride. So I'd like to share with you a few traps, prayer traps, especially the prayer traps that this Pharisee in our scripture fell into. The first trap is a trap of misguided misdirection. It seems to me we must always maintain an awareness of the one who we actually are praying to. Are we really praying to God? Or are we simply praying to ourselves? This morning's scripture tells us what? Let me go back to it. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. Prayed about himself. In another translation, it says he prayed to himself. Well, whether it's about himself or to himself, it doesn't make any difference. It's still misguided and misdirected prayer. Too often we do what the Pharisee did. We pray about ourselves, never even thinking about asking for help from God. We live our life depending only on ourselves, with our own smarts, our own abilities, and when we pray to God, we address Him with our own abilities. Yes, we are praying to God. We address Him with our lips,
but secretly we breathe in our own hearts that we can find the internal gumption, the talent, and the courage to solve all our own problems, and we don't need God. We can do it without any interference from God. And if this is the case, then we are misguided just as much as the Pharisee was. We need to be like little Johnny, who went to a prayer meeting with a request. He walked into the prayer meeting and he says, "I would like to have you pray for my sister, that the Spirit of God will come into her life and that she will start reading the Bible more." "Well, certainly," the group says, "we'll be glad to pray for your sister." And so they begin praying. And they went for about 5, 10, 15 minutes praying for his sister. And suddenly Johnny got up and walked out. And somebody stopped him and says, "It's rude that you're walking out while we're still praying for your sister." And Johnny replied, "Well, you've prayed for 15 minutes for my sister. I'm going home now because I'm sure God has had plenty of time to work on her." Johnny knew that prayer to God could work. He knew that prayer to God could work. And Jesus also knew that because he deeply prayed to God and not to himself. And Jesus prayed for God's will to be done. Jesus acknowledged God's sovereignty even in trying circumstances. Jesus knew that on that last night that he was here on this earth, in the Garden of Gethsemane, that God was his guide and that prayers could be directed to God and to God alone. The Pharisee needed to learn that. And you know, sometimes we need to learn it too. But our Pharisee also falls into another trap. The Pharisee and the tax collectors are both in the temple together. One's in the front of the temple and all his garrity, one beautiful robes and that kind of stuff, and one is in the back of the temple. I had a painting once that had that. I don't know whatever happened to it, but it was a painting showing the guy that was in the front, the Pharisee. He was just, you could see he was just gloriously praying, and the guy in the back was on his knees and praying, but in tears. They're both in prayer, but the Pharisee falls into a trap. And what's the trap? Comparison. It's comparison. He says in his prayer how wonderful he is in comparison to others, especially that tax collector. This is a trap that can creep into all of us. "Oh Lord, I'm glad that I am not a bank robber. I'm not a drug addict. I'm not a drunk." Put whatever you want to say in that list there. "I'm not a wife beater. I'm not whatever else you want to say. I am an all-around good person. I attend church regularly, not like those who never attend." The trap is that we assume that we must compare ourselves to others. That's the trap. One man rewrote this Pharisee prayer this way: "I thank thee, Lord, that I am a North Carolinian and not from Virginia or even a South Carolina. There are mountains of conceit from the South Carolina people. In fact, I am an Eastern Carolinian, for no gentleman was ever born in the West. Especially, Lord, I thank you that I'm a Southerner and not a Yankee, for there are many things which might be endured, but being a Yankee is the most impossible to endure." The trap, of course, in those words is that we assume it is others to whom we must be compared to. God and Christ's reality is that we must compare ourselves to ourselves. The comparison, friends, must always be between ourselves. Ourselves and ourselves alone, and using God's standards for each of us. The Ten Commandments, for example, begins what? How we must behave with each other. All with the understanding that how we behave with others reflects on the relationship that we have with God. There are still valid rules, those Ten Commandments. Those commandments have nothing to do with whether you have kept them better than Susie or better than Mr. Bob, who lives down the street and sits in the next pew. It has a lot to do with how you have kept them yourself. A writer, Don Henderson, reports encountering this "I'm better than you are" attitude when he ran into a middle-aged man in a police station parking lot in Huntington, Kentucky. The man called out to Mr. Henderson, "Are you saved, brother?" When Henderson didn't reply, the man says, "I just got out of jail, and I was arrested because I was drunk, and I have a better relationship with God than you do. The chaplain came in and saved me. Give me $5, and I will get down on my knees and pray for you and for your salvation. We all need to be saved. I will pass the word on to the man upstairs about your conversion." Henderson asked, "Well, that's all nice, but why would it cost me $5? The man says, "Well, I pray better after I've had a few drinks." It can become so easy, doesn't it, to think that we are superior to somebody else. How thankful, but how flawed we can be, assuming that our spirituality places us closer to God than the person next door. And that's a trap. This is, and it can impede and cripple our entire prayer life. Rich or poor, supposedly spiritual or not, biblical scholar or biblical illiterate, we all need to pray and work for God. And the question is not, am I better than my neighbor? Rather, the prayer must be, what do you, O God, want me to do? Our Pharisee falls into one more trap as he prays. He is arrogantly confident about himself. He is so certain he is better, and he believes this based on what he does, and he gets caught in the ego center evidence of his life. Listen to him as I go back to the scripture. He stood at a distance. "God, I thank you that I'm not like the other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tackler. I fast twice a week, and I give a tenth of all that I get." Rather than asking God for guidance, what is the Pharisee doing? He's spending his time telling the Almighty God how great he is. And his prayer, what? It's then, it's no so much for himself. There is no needed openness to God's will for his life, but rather a bottom line report as of what a good boy he is. What a trap this can be for all of us. Thank you, Lord, for using me to do all that work in the church. What a shame that more will not volunteer to work as good and as hard as I do. I am grateful. Or, I am grateful, dear Heavenly Father, that I am able to sing in the choir and help all those monotones to become as great a singer as I am. Compare this to the prayer of the tax collector, a hated figure in Jesus' day. God, have mercy to me, a sinner. A simple, direct prayer. Asking for mercy and indirectly saying, Lord, use me for your work. Show me your ways. As Jesus says, the exalted will be humbled, the humbled exalted. God is aware of what we do, what we will do not do. A laundry list of achievements for the Almighty. Approval is not needed in our prayer life. If anyone could have expected God to recognize the brilliance that he had, Abraham Lincoln could have been that way. If anyone could have compared himself to others and come out on top, it would have been the 16th president of the United States. Here was a man who knew who was in charge, God. A personal friend of Lincoln's wrote in his memoirs these words, I had been spending 3 weeks at the White House. Lincoln had invited me there. And one night, I couldn't sleep. It was right before the Battle of Bull Run. I was restless and could not sleep, and from Lincoln's bedroom I heard the low tones of his voice, and I went to the bedroom thinking something might be wrong with the president and maybe I could help. And when I got to the door, it was slightly ajar, and I looked in and I saw a sight that I have never forgotten, the man writes in his memoirs. The tall chief executive Lincoln was kneeling on the floor with an open Bible. And he did not know I overheard the agonizing supplications, but I heard him plead, O thou great God who heard Solomon in the night when he prayed and cried out for wisdom, hear me. I cannot lead these people. I cannot give the effect or guide the affairs of this country without your help. O Lord, hear me and save this nation. Lincoln knew that relying on God and God alone was a way to avoid prayer traps ahead. So did the tax collector. And so can you, and so can I, when we know that we are simply must go to God and say, Lord, here I am. Forgive me. Use me. I am your child. On you alone I will depend. That ancient tax collector in Jesus' story knew how to avoid prayer traps. He opened himself up to God. And his words, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner, that could be a challenge to anybody who reads this story, including you and me. Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. You pray that prayer and truly mean it and open your heart. You know what will happen? You will bind yourself to the Almighty God. And being bound to the Almighty God, he will help you and support you and love you and care for you and pick you up whenever you fall down. Let us pray. God, help us to truly be your servants. Help us to know that you are here. Help us to open our hearts to you. Amen. Now as you leave this day, truly realize we all need to go to God in prayer. Maybe not an hour, but we do need to go to God in prayer. Lift up your hearts, lift up your souls, lift up your mind, and give them to God. And God will bless you in many ways. Amen. Thank you.